In this lecture, we're going to talk about what happens after you pass your exam. You just got the congratulations. We're pleased to inform you that you have provisionally passed your certification exam. I mean, those are some of the most awesome words you can see on a piece of paper, maybe outside of winning the lottery. So you passed. All your hard work, your time, your effort, your money, it all paid off. High five. But you're not done yet. Yes, you have passed the exam, but now you need to get endorsed. The endorsement is where someone vouches for your work experience. The best you can do here is getting someone who's already IC2 certified. They say yes, they have first-hand knowledge of your working experience. They agree with what you put down on your application, and you then submit that. You go to the IC2 website, and then you start the online endorsement form. And no, I cannot endorse you. I don't know you personally. I can vouch for your work experience. It has to be someone who actually knows you, someone who has first-hand knowledge of your work experience. Now, if you don't know someone who's already IC2 certified, you can ask IC2 to do the endorsement for you. And the process here is really the same. The only difference is, instead of getting someone who's already IC2 certified, you ask a colleague or your boss. Since it's not someone who's already certified, you have a slightly higher chance of getting audited. And an audit is where IC2 is going to ensure that the work experience you have on your resume and that you submitted to IC2 is actually true. But obviously it is, right? You didn't lie on the application, so it's all good. With the endorsement, you need to have 5 years of work experience in the field and within the domains of your certification. And the 5 years is full-time work experience. That means you work 35 hours or more a week with this topic. But if you haven't worked with it full-time for 5 years, that's fine. Then to get the 5 years needed, you can, for instance, within the last 10 years, have worked with it 50% of the time. Then for every full year you work, then half a year counts towards your experience. And it's hard for me to judge when students ask me, does this qualify? Well, is it on any of the domains? If it is, then it most likely does. If you need a definitive answer, you need to contact IC2 and their support. Once you submit your endorsement, IC2 looks at it, and once they're done with the endorsement, once it is accepted, you are officially certified. Now, if you don't have the work experience, that is perfectly fine too. You can still pass the exam, and then until you get the required work experience, you are an associate of IC2. That just means you pass the exam, but you don't have the work requirements. Let's say you have 3 years of experience, then from the time you pass your exam, you have 6 years to gain the remaining. Meaning if you work full-time within the domains of the certification, in 2 years, you're fully certified. Then once you have that experience, you go through the endorsement process and now you're actually certified. And a little reminder here, once you pass the certification and you have been endorsed, this is very important, it is an and, then you can start using the certification logo on your resume or your applications or your LinkedIn profile. But do not do it before the endorsement is done. To be certified, you need to pass the exam and get endorsed. You need to have both. Since you have worked so hard for this, there's really no point in jeopardizing your certification just so you can say, I'm certified a few weeks earlier. And after you're fully certified, now you need to make sure that your certification stays valid and current. For that, you need the two things we talked about already. You need to pay the annual maintenance fees. For the certified in cybersecurity, it's $50 a year. For any other IC2 certification in the US right now, it's $125. Again, may depend on where you live. Once you have given IC2 the money, you also need to earn CPEs. Those were the continual professional education credits we talked about earlier. And if you do both, if you do the CPEs and the AMFs, you should never need to take the exam again unless you let it lapse, meaning not paying the AMFs or not doing the CPEs. And the CPEs are really what you do to prove that you are continually learning about IT security and you're staying informed about what's happening in the field. For the certified in cybersecurity, you need 15 annual CPEs, a total of 45 per cycle. For the CISP, you need 40, a total of 120. And for the CCSP, you need 30, a total of 90 over 3 years. And you can obviously get more than that, but this is the minimum. So every year, you need to have a certain amount of hours of certification-related training. That can be webinars, articles, conferences, video training for other certifications, but you need to keep learning. And there really are a ton of different things out there that you can use to keep your certification current. There are two different types of CPEs, Group A and Group B. Group A is everything that's directly related to the certification, and Group B is professional development. Professional development means communication courses, management courses. It's some sort of professional development, but it's not directly related to the certification. It's all the other stuff that makes you better at your job. For the CC, you don't have Group B CPEs. For the CISP and CCSP, you can earn up to 10 a year. The rest have to be directly related. Getting your CPEs doesn't have to cost a lot of money. There is a ton of websites that have acceptable CPEs where you can go, learn something new, and then apply that towards your recertification. In the next lecture, I'm going to have some links to sites where you can go and get free or inexpensive CPEs. I, for instance, have a lot of students that just do the IC Squared web seminars because those CPEs are automatically applied. Now, if you do something that's not automatically applied, it really is super simple still. I mean, it takes less than a minute to enter your CPEs. You go to the IC Squared website, then you go to the member page, you click on Submit CPE, then you type what type of CPEs they are, where you took it, how many hours you spent, whatever proof you have of this, and then you hit Submit. Me personally, before I started training other people, I would do more training. I would go, I would find a video course that had a certificate of completion. That way, you have the proof I completed this training, and you don't just get the one CPE here and one CPE there for the podcasts. You earn one CPE per hour spent. If I take a course that takes 25 hours, well then I get 25 CPEs. Most of the times, if I have the proof, I submit it right away, but you don't have to. There is then, after you submit, a small chance you'll get audited and you then have to prove this is the CPEs I took. Here then, you just submit that certificate of completion. So look through the links in the next section, start on your next certification, use the certificate of completion from your video courses, but also here, keep in mind, you cannot start earning CPEs before the first of the month following you becoming fully certified. Meaning, if you became fully certified, that is the exam and the endorsement, and that was improved on May 10th, then you cannot start earning CPEs until June 1st. And with that, we are done with this lecture. I hope this has helped you answer some of the questions that you may have on what to do once you pass your exam and how to maintain your certification. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.